we have once again an amazing interview, as I've teased pretty much for the past 30 minutes exclusively. And we are so excited to have the president of Montclair State, Jonathan Coppell. Sir, how are you on this beautiful, chilly day?
Good morning. I'm thrilled to be here. And you say it's chilly, but I'm excited because I'm clearly the hottest radio station.
You are the hottest station in the nation.
It is impressive. It is impressive. You guys are serious about it.
Yeah, that we are all about dedication to our viewers, and we are willing to put up with 95 degree weather on the thermostat.
I don't even think the summer got this hot or this warm.
I know.
You know, but it is what it is. We're
it
committed.
It is what it is. Hey, guys. The college tour is filming on campus, and the MSU show will be airing next year. The show gives an inside look into the university's campuses through the lens of current students, and you filmed your portion last week. How exciting is this, and is there a correlation between universities being on the show and an increase in numbers of applications?
Well, the college tour is a really good show. If you guys haven't seen it, it's a little late for you. You guys have already chosen, so hopefully you don't look at the other schools and be like, God, could have gone there. But what it is a way of people getting a glimpse at life on different campuses as they're making the show. Actually, you talked about being a commuter. Not everybody can afford to go flying around the country and look at universities. And so right. The college tour is a way to do that, you know, sort of virtually. And I think it's going to be awesome. The producers, including the host, who's a guy named Alex Boylan, who got his start in media. So you guys are cutting your teeth here. He got started as the winner of Survivor.
Wow.
And you would appreciate it. He was saying he was on the show and he was supposed to be competing, but he just wanted to ask the producers questions and how's it working and what are you doing? And he just caught the bug and has been in television since. And he had this idea from his niece to show off the campuses because she was trying to figure out where she wanted to go to college. So we did this segment here. I'll tell you, they said, first of all, they were blown away by how beautiful our campus was and they just loved it. And they said, this is easily in the top 2% of schools that they've seen. And they just felt that the vibe was so positive. The energy was good that it stood out even from going around to universities. That's what they do. So I was pretty pumped about that. And I do know that these things really show off the university well. It so happens that I was at ASU when they did, I think it was the second episode or the third episode, they did ASU, and it really was great. The students did a great job of presenting the university, and that's what really came through. And they said, same deal, Montclair is gonna show off great. What's it gonna do? I don't know. We have anecdotal evidence, not like hard data, that at least one of the schools, for the first time after it aired, they got applications from all 50 states. It was reaching a whole new range of students. I think that this is going to open people's eyes to Montclair State University in a way that it didn't before. And they'll learn things like we have this awesome award-winning radio station that is literally, you know, among the very best in the nation. And I don't think people necessarily know that because they don't know that there's this thing called Montclair State University. But that's the truth, right? They just don't know. And so once their eyes are opened, I think that, whoa. I ask a lot of people, why did you come here? And they're like, well, I didn't know anything about it. And then I started reading about it and it was awesome. And so I came. And so I think this is going to change people's awareness. And I think that's the biggest hump for us is just getting people aware. And once they see all there is to do here, they're in.
Yeah, I agree. Absolutely. I think that you said that people don't really know about Montclair. And I agree because sometimes when you go on Google and you put MSU, you get Michigan State. And you don't get like actual Montclair State. So I would actually have to like put Montclair State University. But I think that's fantastic. And, you know, going along how beautiful our campus is, MSU has a long history of lifers, meaning people who attend MSU and love it so much that they find a job on campus. We know this is only your third month as president, but in this short time, can you talk about what makes our university so special that it fosters this environment of people wanting to make MSU part of their everyday life after graduation?
Well, I'm not an expert on that, but I've certainly seen what you're talking about. I mean, I meet people who, you know, who are like, yeah, I came as a student and I've been here for the last 25 years. You see it, and it's not restricted to one part of the campus or one unit or anything like that. It's all over the place. I think there are variables. I mean, I think it's got a very comfortable feeling very supportive, that people feel at home here. Mm-hmm. I think that's part of it. And it's interesting because a lot of people said, well, you know, there's not a campus life in the same way. That's what a lot of students lament because of, well, you're talking about being a commuter student. So people come and go each day. Mm-hmm. But it's not a big party scene, I guess, compared to some colleges, but I think people feel kind of relaxed. And just at ease, and they can be themselves here. That's the sense that I have. And mm-hmm. so they don't want to leave, because it's a good feeling. It's like cozying up next to a fire. You don't necessarily want to get up and go away. Well, what I'm curious, more interested in your guys' answer to that question than my, what's your answer to your own question?
Why I came to MSU
why do you think people stick around for 30 years?
And it's interesting because I have this friend, her name is Elena Plumser, and she graduated last May, and she's been working with the School of Communication and Media, and she is committed to securing a full-time job, on campus, or specifically with SEM. And to me, it amazes me because she's, at least for me, I know you said there's people like that all around campus, and I'm sure there is, but I'd never met someone in person. So for her to be this committed, I was blown away. But I think it's definitely the vibe. I know you, I thought it was funny when you said that the vibe and just the atmosphere, but it's true. It's just how homey it is, and it's a beautiful campus. That I feel like is something Montclair, nobody can take away from Montclair State. It is a beautiful campus. It gives me that, or at least I'm Mexican-American. So over there, it's very like that. So it's like white paint and bright colors, or it just has nice decorations. So I definitely think it's like the homey feel, and just how great everyone is. Like, it's not only the students that you get to meet, but it's also the staff.
Yeah.
So I think it's a little bit of a combination of both. So for me, it's that. How about you, Isaiah?
For me, I think that you guys both kind of nailed it. It's just, you don't really, it's hard to explain a vibe that people feel. And that's ultimately what it comes down to, is when you first get here on campus, you're like, oh, I'm just going to classes. It's just university. But then when you start to actually go to campus, it feels different, because there's a difference between showing up and being involved. And once you get involved, that's when you really start to create a bond with the entire campus. And then you love coming here, except for the, you know, the crazy weather and all that. That's not ideal, but
I had to wear a coat this morning.
Me too.
You don't understand, after living for a decade in Arizona. So mm-hmm. it looked like a coat. what?
Speaking of that, I want to learn a little bit more about that. So you have come from a pretty warm state in Arizona, and you, for some reason, I'm not entirely sure why, you came here to MSU where it is freezing. It is windy. It's snowy. It's disgusting. While you were living this gorgeous weather.
It didn't have that in the brochure.
So. No, it did not. They don't put it on there. They never do.
It didn't. We didn't have the college tour come in February. No. We told them we were busy then.
So what I'm interested to know is, what are some of the similarities between your time in Arizona and your time here so far?
Well, I think that the DNA of the school is similar. And that's why I'm here. I wanted to be at a university that had similar values, in the sense that it was, first of all, a public university that is dedicated to serving the public. So when I say a public university, I don't mean, yeah, we get some of our budget from the state. Obviously, that's what people think of when they think of public university, a declining share of money. But what makes this a public university is that it's committed to serving the public interest, right? That's what makes Montclair, that we're about serving the community, that we're about creating access for everybody in society to be able to get a higher education. That's what Arizona State's about. Mm-hmm. Full stop. Same basic mission. So that's part of it. But then I would say, on top of that, it's an institution that, like ASU, sets its aspiration to be higher than just another school, right? Mm-hmm. We're saying, we're going to show that, first of all, there's nothing inconsistent with being a university committed to access where people from every background can come and get a great degree. There's nothing inconsistent with also saying, we're going to be an excellent university of the finest quality. And I got and that's everything that we do. It's, yes, it's the academics, it's the science, it's the research, it's all that stuff, but it's also the student experience. So let me just use this as a minute to say, so we're going to have the best college radio station in the country. You guys just nailed it. I mean, I don't know if you're going to have enough room in the studio for all the awards you brought in on Friday. Just amazing. And the point is, like, you can be a public serving university and also achieve at the highest levels. That's what ASU set as its goal. That's what Montclair sets as its goal. And so to me, that's incredibly comfortable. I also like, in terms of, you know, my answer to the question of why I would like to hang out here, I love the diversity of the of the population. I just think that makes it a more fun place to be, that you've got people from all over the place with different backgrounds. I think you've got some students living here, you got some people commuting, you've got different racial and ethnic diversity, you've got people different life experiences, you've got some returning students. I think that's exciting. It's fun, it's energetic. And that's very similar to my experience at ASU. You know, dynamic place where there's always something happening. And then there's some things that I feel are similar, but there's the potential to really grow it. So to me, being engaged in the community and forming collaborations between the university and partners, whether they're governments or nonprofit organizations, community groups, you can work together. You can solve problems together. That's what we can do here. That was what I worked on really passionately in Arizona. And so I'm just excited about the potential in the surrounding communities that we serve. But, you know, think about Patterson and Newark, where we have a history of our students doing work in teaching and health and any number of topics. That's what we can build here. So I just think it's a great place to do the things that I'm passionate about. And I feel the same passion in the students, faculty, and staff.
Yeah, and I feel like we're all excited to see, you know, the changes that you will bring and, like, everything that will change or will even perhaps get better. So I think I speak for a lot of people when we say
hopefully not change for the worse. You're right. That is change, though. You're right.
But now that the pandemic has brought some changes as well, let's talk about some recent news. The university released a flexible work arrangement that goes into effect on Monday, November 8th. Although this change was ushered in quickly by the global pandemic in March 2020, the policy seems to provide a detailed long path for eligible employees to benefit from flexible work arrangements, including 1 to 3 days working remotely, compressed schedule, and several more others. Who on campus is eligible? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, so the policy is really responding to the reality that that's what people are looking for, right? Is flexibility in their work schedule. And we want it to be responsive to that. And in fact, that's what the market is sort of requiring of us, because people are looking for that and making choices. It's an interesting time, actually, to see people making choices about their employment based on their own needs, their own desires and preferences. So we're being responsive to that. But of course we have to run a university. So the question of eligibility is really one about job functionality and can your job be done in an effective way on a remote work basis? So there's no uniform answer. It's not like I can tell you everybody above pay grade, whatever, or, you know, it really comes down to the nature of the job and can it be done in a remote way. And quite frankly, that's not even something that's fixed. You might think that it can be done remotely and it doesn't work out, or the opposite, right? You might come up with some way to do a job that you hadn't thought of in one way or another. In fact, even the same jobs are challenging because it goes back to the variation among our students. Not everybody has access to the same technology. Not everybody has, and you all know this, you lived through the pandemic. Not everybody had the same bandwidth to do their classes on Zoom. Not everybody even has a quiet room in their house where they can close the door and do a class together. So that means that you can't presume that the jobs that are done on campus can be done that way. So can some people do advising on Zoom? Yes. Can you have all your advisors only available for remote advising? No, right? So then you say, well, is advisor, is that a job that's subject to remote work? It's like, yes. somewhat. But there's no right. There's no generic answer to that question. I think this is something that we're going to be working through, right, to figure out how to optimize it, so that the university can still work at the highest level, but we're meeting staff where they need to be to manage their lives.
Right.
Absolutely.
And are there any drawbacks? I'm curious. Like, I know that we talked a little bit about like the good stuff that may come from this policy, but is there any drawbacks from it?
Yeah, well, let's get back to what you said you like about the campus. It's the culture, it's the feeling. So the question is that something that can be maintained when people are increasingly working away from the campus? Do you still have that same homey feeling when people are on Zoom and not interacting face to face? I think one of the things that happened during the pandemic was a lot of people said, see, this is fine. Like, we've all been working at home and we can do this. And it's like, well, wait a second though. You were working together in the same office for 5 years before you went remote. That doesn't mean that if you onboarded people and they never saw each other face to face, that the same thing would be true. And in my experience, people who started jobs during the pandemic where they actually never met their colleagues and they never experienced the office culture, they did not do so well. And that did not work so well. So I think it's the question of maintaining sort of campus and organizational culture and effectiveness, even as you're learning to do things in these new ways. That's the big uncertainty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So each year, SEM media entities and class work on a topic of interest under the name Focus. This year, our focus project is disruption in the workplace, in education, and mental health, and climate and misinformation. We just spoke about the workplace, but the pandemic has also disrupted education. We can't help but mourn snow days. What are some changes the university adopted during the pandemic in classrooms that deserve to be explored beyond the pandemic as resources for students, recruitment, retention, and success?
Yeah, it's funny you use the word disruption, which it sounds like the way you're using it sort of negative. Disruption is good. but it's true. I mean, there's all kinds of things, you know, if you have a fundamentally bad racist society, right, I want disruption, right?
Exactly. Yeah, absolutely.
Disruption. You have a point. Disruption throws things up in the air, which can shake things up and make them better. It can make them worse too, obviously, mm-hmm. but it can make them better. And so, yeah, I think this was a huge disruption. I think the disruption that says, you know, not everybody has to be in the office every day of the week to do their work, that's a good disruption, right? Because it's going to make people's lives better. It maybe has some environmental benefits if there's less commuting, right? And so there's a lot of things there. I think that the disruption to the educational sort of system is going to end up being a huge positive, because we learned that there are lots of different ways that people can interact with each other, can interact with faculty, can interact educationally and still get good outcomes. And I think we're at the very beginning. We're like, you know, that fish that's starting to crawl out of the slime in terms of how we start to use these new techniques, right? I think we've thought of like, though, there's face-to-face and there's online. And now it's like, well, why can't we mix these things together a little bit more? And mm-hmm. why can't we, instead of saying, well, we're going to go all Zoom, what if we had Zoom once in a while? And what if we had classes that were structured where some of it was in person, some of it was remote? And why does the remote have to be what we would call synchronous, right? Where you're sitting in class together. Why can't it be a mix of synchronous, asynchronous, and remote synchronous? And why does it have to be the same every week? What if we had a couple of weeks that were remote, and that you start putting things together in mm-hmm. different ways. You know, think of each class as like a Lego set where you have different colored pieces to do different things, and your whole degree program can be that way. So I think what the disruption says is, let's right size the pieces of people's education for the content and the activity. And I think we can do things that will be exciting and different. And the part that I think is really cool about that is it might make college accessible for people who otherwise would have a really hard time doing it, right? If you're taking care of kids or taking care of parents or working a full-time job or whatever, your schedule doesn't allow you to come to campus every day. And now we say, yeah, but we can meet you. We can meet you where you are. Now, all of a sudden, some people who just couldn't make it work all right, there's a pathway that's available. And so I think that's what's exciting about this moment.
And I love that, because I feel like you're right. For me personally, and I think for a lot of my friends, it's like we thrive off of in-person classes. This past year, it was rough and it's been just been complicated, but we thrive in person. But I also know other people who are like, no, I like Zoom. It just takes away that anxiety, this, that, and the fourth. So I love that it could, it's like what you said, the disruption is happening, but it doesn't have to be a bad thing. And I think you're actually one of the first persons I've heard them say that. Like, it's not taking the positive look on disruption. So that's fantastic. But everyone has gone through trauma in the past 20 months, and the pandemic is not over, although things are better. However, it seems that we collectively feel like we went to war and are more exhausted than usual, myself included. How is the university addressing the increased demand of mental health needs for students? But also, how is it addressing for faculty and staff's mental health?
Yeah, I think the biggest change in this regard is it's a hugely positive change, is we're talking about it, right? We're actually talking about people's mental well-being, and we are viewing that as part of the responsibility of running a healthy campus as people's state of mind, and that's dramatically new and different. Compared even in my lifetime, I'm not that old. And where that was not something that would be talked about. And the other part that I think is interesting about it is that students, and this is to great credit of, talk about an old person thing to say, but of your generation, but I think it's true to students are totally fine saying like, yeah, we want more help. We want more counseling, That was, I don't remember ever hearing a student say that when I was in college. And mm-hmm. So I think that's great. I think we have to figure out how to get the resources available to meet students. It's not easy, like everything else. You know, you have the hiring challenge, bringing people on is hard, and finding the resources, I'll be honest with you, right? Finding the resources to do it is hard. Everybody says they want more mental health services from campus, and they want, okay, but nobody wants to pay more tuition and so on, right? So that's always the dilemma, right? Which is, how do you make it work? And the same thing about resources for faculty and staff, right? I think part of the going to the flexible work policy is being responsive to people's stress levels, right? That in this time, like, people are, you know, yes, they're happy to be back interacting in person, but they're also still dealing with childcare issues, and they're also still, and so the stress of having to come to work every day for some people is added. And so where we could be responsive to that, we will be. There's no quick fix on this. Where I think you said we've gone to war. I hear that, right? I mean, I hear that metaphor. I've heard that before. But the only thing that worries me about that is I don't think that there's an end point. Yeah, the pandemic is winding down in terms of it in our region, mm-hmm. but the stress of life these days is high, right? I think this is not like, oh, it's over and now everything's back to, you know, now it's like, you know, some sitcom life where everything's fine and everybody's just laughing and we go and sit and have coffee together. You know, I think the world is stressful. The politics we live in is stressful. The culture of the moment is stressful. And so ultimately, I think what we're going to have to do is add to the education part of it, which is tools to manage that, mm-hmm. and to learn together, myself included, how to just deal with a heightened level of anxiety and sort of agitation in daily life. And that's part of what you can gain from being here at Montclair is those tools. And I think we need to build that into the experience.
Absolutely.
I have a white hair. The other day I was looking at my Same. Hair and I got a white hair and I was like, wow, I'm stressed. this is the result of being stressed. So I can't even imagine.
I started doing yoga. I think that's more exercise to me, but I think I actually feel like that has some mental benefit. I didn't do it for that, but now I get it. So yeah, we each have to find our own. Mm-hmm. We got to find our own thing.
I agree. 1000%.
I think a streak of white hair would look cool.
It's somewhere in there.
I don't know. I've had it for quite some time. It is not a good look. Not at all. But moving on, in regards to climate, we are all experiencing crazy weather events at a faster rate than in the past. The university's green teams address a number of community issues related to the environment and climate change. However, being a big commuter school means there are plenty of individual cars traveling to and from campus. Only one needs to be on Clove Road at 8-ish a.m. or between 4 and 6 p.m. to make it 20 minutes or even so when you leave campus. How can we all work to solve that problem?
Yeah, the traffic situation, I'm aware of the traffic situation, obviously. I do think it's partially going to get better when the construction on 46 and 3, you know, when that's done. I realize that's easy to say, it's a year out or something like that. But I do think that's part of the problem. All you have to do is go down there one time and see people like, you know, with their knuckles white on the steering wheel, afraid to pull into 46 yep. because and everybody's terrified that they're going to get hit by, you know, an 18 wheeler. And that slows things down considerably, but it is what it is, right? We have we've got a campus that's kind of landlocked in there and cars are squeezing in and out. And we got a lot of people riding cars. So one is, you know, to push for better ways that people can get here, not in cars. We've got one commuter, I heard you say. Mm-hmm. So I think that's important. Some of this accessing the campus in different ways is part of the deal. And honestly, this is a societal issue, right? We're not going to solve it. If everybody's coming in a single car, I don't have a magic wand that's going to, you know, right. Until we have, you know, flying cars that can come to campus, there's going to be a squish to get people all on at the same time. I think we can do a better job of making the campus accessible by foot so that people can, you know, walk from lot 60 and those parking options are more appealing. But I'm not going to sit here and tell you like I've got a big solution that somehow makes it possible for people to come in on a freeway to campus. There is no quick answer on that. I think we can push for more commuting options and try and create methods by which students maybe can carpool together or figure out some sort of satellite option where that can help. But I don't think there's a magic bullet on this one. And it's funny, people talk about electric cars and those sorts of things, which I think are good, obviously. But it doesn't solve electric cars doesn't solve. Then you just have, you know, you have a lot less, you have electric car traffic jam, but it's still a traffic jam.
And even if we do get electric cars and, you know, it's better for the environment, it's not going to be better for traffic.
No, exactly.
and I know you mentioned that construction is like a huge or contributing factor of why there's so much traffic, but I've only been here, I think I'm going to 3 years now, but there's other people who've been here longer and they said that construction on 46 has been going on for years. So if it's going on for years and there's been a traffic issue, it's getting worse, is there any other like solution we're working towards to try to
there's been an attempt to create a different exit onto Valley Road so that not everything is dumping right onto Clove Road. That's gotten complicated. There's a whole history of back and forth with the town of Clifton about that.
I saw.
We haven't given up on that. So I think that could help a little bit. But look, again, there's not, so if cars come out that way, then they go onto Valley Road. So if you guys know how this works, right? So if you come around Clove and turn left on Normal, where do you end up?
Back there.
Valley Road, right? So we are where we are. there's nothing that we can do. We're not going to move the campus to adjacent to the New Jersey Turnpike to get better traffic flow. I think it's the nature of the beast. I think that we can work on some things maybe around scheduling to try and get people coming mm-hmm. to campus at different times. I think the more, I mean, this is going to sound like a funny thing, but the more activities and reasons there are for people to hang out on campus, the more you can get varied arrival times. And so you don't have everybody crushing on the same commuting schedule. And so maybe there's some opportunities there, but look, Clove Road is not going to become a four lane, you know, in each direction road. Valley Road's not going to become a highway. Normal Avenue is Normal Avenue. So yes, there could be marginal things over the years about traffic lights and crossing areas and but fundamentally, you're here to be on campus and to enjoy the environment. And it's not it's not designed for maximum driving in and out efficiency. I don't think that's what we signed up for when we came here, right? And so I can't tell you that it's ever going to be the greatest. I will say this: traffic expands to meet the size of the roads that are provided. So there's no place like LA has a lot of big roads, right, with a lot of more lanes of traffic, and they still have traffic. So there's no quick fix that says, oh, well, if only we had more X, Y, and Z, we wouldn't have a problem. I just don't think it just doesn't work that way.
Right. So what are you saying is that New Jersey traffic is part of the equation?
I think so. I think it's a deal. Well, but I think it is. I must say I grew up in New York, but I didn't realize that New Jersey is much more car centric even than my experience growing up in New York.
You know, I think we should probably invest in that magic wand of yours and hopefully we'll get things going that way. But this is an alternative rock and talk radio station, and we must ask, what is in your playlist these days?
So I'm totally quirky, and what I'm going to say is totally true, that I just, stuff gets in my head. So because I'm trying to become of the people, I'm listening to Bruce Springsteen's, his book, Born to Run. So I was totally jamming on Bruce Springsteen the other day. I was laughing. I'm like, they're gonna say like that's lame. Like you're saying Bruce Springsteen because now I do free associate, right? So when I hear Bruce Springsteen, I very quickly want to hear John Mellencamp afterwards. So I went over to that. But I like a really quirky, weird set of lists. Like so I'll when I'm working out, I go to an 80s. I go to an 80s playlist. I can't help it. I'm of my generation.
We love the 80s here.
Yeah, exactly. I think I do. But also weird stuff. Like I was really into Chuck Mangione. Do you know who Chuck Mangione is? Like you're gonna be like, what?
No.
I see Annabelle is like, I know who that is. It's good. If you ever want to rock out to a flugelhorn playing some I know you're thinking that all the time. Like, I don't hear enough flugelhorn in my life. That's the answer. But also I like show tunes. I like a lot. Like I'm down with Broadway music. Like I like everything. It's an eclectic playlist that's on my Spotify.
Right.
You know, we appreciate the originality in your playlist selection. It is unlike no other. So, knowing how much you love masks, we saw your strong TikTok game for Halloween, and we wanted to help you stay safe.
Thank you for not making fun of me.
No, it was beautiful. I almost cried on how much of a performance that truly was. But we would love to give you a very own WMSC mask for you to rock.
Nice.
You have a beautiful logo that is FCC compliant on the front. It is just, oh, magic.
I always look for FCC compliance in my logos.
Oh, absolutely.
And especially as us as DJs, we have to be FCC and keep in line with that. So now you get to have one and rep us all around when you are on campus.
Sweet.
Absolutely. And you know what? Thank you so much for joining us here in the morning so early, so freezing. It's terrible outside. We apologize for the weather in New Jersey.
It's not terrible. It's a gorgeous sunrise.
What are you talking? You know, this is the first time we're going to disagree on air. We need three coats. At least in here, it's nice and hot. Would you like to take us to break, perhaps?
I would. This is Montclair State University's radio station, 90.3 WMSC Upper Montclair, where music stays cool.